the book of Proverbs, to survey the book of Proverbs and see what are the subjects that are repeated in the book of Proverbs, because we know that Proverbs was intended to give wisdom and knowledge in the fear of the Lord. And this was primarily written by a father to his children. So again, we will continue our survey. We group together passages from Proverbs that are repeated. And repetition indicates that the author of Proverbs regarded these subjects as vital in the training of our children. First, we saw that from the repeated passages that parents must admonish their children to be attentive listeners to godly parental instruction, guidance, and warning. Secondly, we saw from these passages that parents must admonish their children to be active in the pursuit of true knowledge and wisdom. Thirdly, parents must admonish their children to learn to desire, welcome, and heed rebuke, correction, and counsel. Parents must, fourthly, must admonish their children to recognize and avoid people and influences which will lead them to defilement. And then fifthly, parents must consistently, repeatedly, and diligently admonish their children on the righteous use of the tongue. And we spend quite a number of days in discussing that particular subject, the use of the tongue. And then last Sunday, we began with the sixth, that parents, as parents, we must continually admonish our children to avoid laziness and its horrible fruit and cultivate diligence and industry with their blessed reward. And by the way, as I've always been saying, that all of these are taken from the lecture of Pastor Al Martin, although I really did not use it word for word, but yung great bulk at yung outline itself is taken from him. So parents must continually admonish our children to avoid laziness and its horrible fruit and cultivate diligence and industry with their blessed reward. We would see that Solomon used strong language to condemn laziness and to warn his children about what would happen if they would grow up to be lazy. But they were also encouraged to be diligent, to be industrious, with the promise of the rewards for industry and diligence. Now, why is there a need for people to be told to be diligent and industrious? You just have to go back to the time of the fall, that during the fall, several things happened. One is that the heart of man became averse to obeying the Lord. Man did not want to obey the Lord. He lived a life of independence. Secondly, what happened is that the earth, whereas when it was first created, just give everything that is needed by man without any effort from man. It just gives everything that was needed for food and for comfort. But then after the fall, the earth somehow parang hamper yung kanyang pagbibigay ng blessing, and man needed to exert effort, to work hard, and have some, sabi, by the sweat of your brow, you will eat yung fruit nung iyong gagawin. So nakita niyo yung combination? It became difficult to get what we want. And that man who will soon find that it would be difficult, is averse to averse to the obedience of the Lord. And one of the command of the Lord is that in 6 days they shall work and rest on the seventh. So ito yung dalawang ito, plus yung naging nasira yung relationship ng mga tao with one another. And therefore, to be able to get what we want, we need to work. But when men work, is doing something that is contrary to his nature. We just want blessing. We just want pleasure. Kaya nakita mo yung pang-akit ngayon sa trabaho, be your own boss. Why do you need to work hard when you can just relax in your home? Be your own boss. Yan yung very attractive sa mga tao. So, yun yung pinaka-root cause ng laziness. And after that, we made again a survey of the passages in Proverbs. We stopped, I think, in Proverbs 12:27, that whoever is thoughtful will not roast his game, but the diligent man will get precious wealth. Whoever is slothful, being slothful does not mean that the person is no longer working, that the person is no longer lifting his hand to do something. The picture is that a slothful person would still work, but will not bring his work to completion to benefit from the work. A slothful person, a lazy person, is a quitter. For today, we begin with Proverbs 13, verse 4. Proverbs 13, verse 4, that says, the soul of the sluggard craves and gets nothing, while the soul of the diligent is richly supplied. The soul of the diligent richly supplied. In the New King James, it says, the soul of the diligent is made rich. But the King James, the soul of the diligent will be made fat. It's the soul, not the tummy. The soul is made fat and not the belly. A sluggard, from this passage, we can deduce that a sluggard knows what is good for life, because he craves for something which he knows is good for life. Alam ng mga sluggard, alam ng mga tamad kung anong mabuti. Perhaps we will all agree that having good food on the table is good. Being under a roof of a comfortable house is good. Having a good income is good. Bringing to the family a good amount of money to be spent for the upkeep of the family, that is good. We all know, even the sluggard, they know what is good for life. Sluggard knows what is good. Meron siyang idea of what is good things in life. But because he refused to use God-ordained means to get it, he gets nothing. These good things in life, God has appointed means, and that means is work. Taking advantage of the opportunity opened by the Lord. The season that the Lord is giving us, all these things are God-ordained means for us to get a good life. In modern times, it could be a good employment or a good scholastic record, or talagang matuto tayo ng skill. These are things that God has appointed for us to be able to get what is good. A sluggard knows everything, but he refuses to use the means that the Lord has ordained that he would be able to get these things. And therefore, Solomon warned his children, you cannot ignore the means of God. You know what is good. And we can imagine that the children of Solomon lived comfortable lives because Solomon was king. You know what is good. And if you want to continue in this good life, God has appointed means for you to be able to do it. If you will not, you will crave. What you want would remain to be dreams, but you will not be able to do it. While the soul of the diligent is richly supplied, or the soul of the diligent is made fat. Now, what is a fat soul? What is a soul that is rich? Kung titignan natin ang overall teaching of the scripture, of the attitude of man, a fat soul is having a legitimate joy of accomplishment. Accomplishment with a clear conscience. It's not simply having a rich pocket. It's not simply being able to have a good bank account. But a fat soul is someone, is something that has a legitimate joy of accomplishment. Looking at what he has accomplished, that these are the fruit of God's, my obedience to God. I did what I had to do, and this was given to me. Ito yung sinasabi. So you can have a fat pocket, you can have a huge amount in the bank, but if your spirit, if your mind, if your conscience cannot say that this is the fruit of my obedience to the Lord, then you still have a poor, you still have a slim soul. You cannot have a fat soul if you're half-hearted in your task, if you're negligent in your task, if let go some responsibility. Kaya nga marami sa mga anak ng mayaman lumaki sa layaw. Sagana sila, but their souls are not really fat. They live with unhealthy soul. They live with a bothered conscience that these things that I have. So they will try, because their conscience are bothered, they will try to enjoy life by spending what they did not earn, spending what they did not work for, and by doing so, lalo silang nababaon sa depression. Lalo silang nababaon sa pagkawala ng joy. So they would still look for things that would make them rejoice. They're because they are impoverished in their soul. Parents, so ang point dito ni Solomon is that we should, parents should praise our children or commend our children more on their effort rather than what they have accomplished. Mas maganda yung kanilang effort. Parents often praise children for what they have accomplished instead of what they have diligently obeyed. Diba, pag nakita natin, maganda yung grade ng ating mga anak. Naku, galing talaga ng anak ko. And then, ipagmamalaki yan sa mga kapitbahay, sa mga, ay, magnakita yung scholar yung anak ko. Ang galing-galing yan. But have we even made an assessment whether that child really worked hard and really diligently obeyed what the Lord has commanded? Eh kasi baka mamaya naturally talented lang yung bata. Naturally intelligent. May mga batang hindi naman masipag mag-aral. Walang ka-effort. Walang, but nagkakaroon ng magandang grades pa rin. Hindi mo pupurihin yung kanyang kalagayan. Doon sa aming magkakapatid, pag tapos ng school, papakita namin doon sa aming mga tito-tita yung aming grades. Meron kaming reward doon sa pinakamataas. 25 centavos. Eh kasi 10 centavos lang naman yung baon namin, eh. Kaya baon namin, may 25 centavos kami para kapag nakuha yun. They will not even bother to look at how much effort we spend earning those grades. I know when I was in high school and from elementary, hindi ako nag-notebook alam ni Senate yun. Wala akong notebook. Nakikinig lang ako sa lecture. Pag nakinig ako sa lecture, natatandaan ko yung mga lessons. Kaya wala akong notebook. Kapag ka, pagka meron ng test, it's either ka-try kong itignan yung brain ko, o kaya manghihiram ako ng mga reviewer, ng mga kaklase ko, titignan ko, and I'm passing. And with good grades, kaya ako'y nakakatanggap ng reward. Dinala ko yung ugaling yung hanggang high school. Wala rin akong notebook ng high school. But high school is different. Hindi kasing, hindi yung katulad ng elementary na simple lang yung mga tinuturo na hanggang ngayon, memorize ko pa yung mga rhymes na tinuturo sa amin noon. High school was different. And I learned the lesson the hard way. Pagdating ko ng second year, bagsak ako sa section 12. Consistent ako from grade 1 hanggang nung araw, wala naman yung section. Nung araw, consistent ako sa section 1. Pagdating ng second year, bagsak sa verse sa section 12. It really pained me and gave me great frustration. So I worked hard, pero wala na sa habit ko yung working hard for study. Wala na siya sa habit ko. Kaya barely nakaakit ako ulit, nakabalik ako doon sa dati, pero nawala na yung mga pangarap ko, ng honor, pag-ganito at pag-ganyan. Why? Because I was awarded for what I have accomplished, or not how hard I worked. Hindi talaga kung gaano ako naging masikap, masipag, and diligent doon sa aking mga ginagawa. One area where this principle is violated. There was one dad na nandun siya, nagbigyan ng award yung kanyang isang anak, kasama niya yung iba, yung mga anak niya. Then one of the parents commented, sabi ko sa parents, "You must be very proud of the child of yours." And the dad said, "No, I'm proud of every child that I have." Why? Because all of them are diligently performing and doing diligently and industriously the task that God has given them. That should be taught. I don't know if it is true, but that in Japan, there are no grading of students until grade 4. Hindi ko alam kung totoo, pero marami na ako nabasang ganun. Na hindi sila nagbibigay ng exam, hindi sila nagbibigay ng test, at walang grade hanggang grade 4. The reason is, they want them first to learn a good habit of education, to work hard, to be diligent, not because of the grade, but because of what? Of how they perform in class. Nung araw sa amin, napakalaking bagay ng grade. Sobrang discrimination nun. Meron ng section 1, section 2, section 3. Pagka section 1 ka, halos hindi kami nakipag-usap dun sa section 2. Mababa yun, section 2 yan. Sa loob pa ng klase, meron pang row 1, row 2, row 3, row 4. Pag row 1 ka, discriminated yung 3 and 4. Pag nakasakay ka ng jeep, may makikita, "Uy, si Roberto." Roberto tuloy na, isip ko hindi si Robert. "Uy, si Roberto, row 4 yan." Yun ang mga sistema ng araw. Instead of, kaya lumaki yung mga bata na ang measurement of having enjoyment is what they produce rather than having that real joy, that real peaceful joy that I have done what the Lord wants me to do. We must work hard on this in our children. Even those who got frustrated because they accomplished little, they must make to realize that it's not what you have done, but how much you obeyed the Lord. Produce children who will always look for what the Lord wants them to do. And do not raise up. Alam mo pagka ang ginawa yung gano'n, yung nakatingin lagi doon sa outcome, kapag hindi nila na-reach yung outcome na yon, they know na they will not be praised for failing to reach what they are supposed to reach. Ang mangyayari nun, maghahanap sila ng sisisihin. They will blame society. They will blame the school. They will blame their parents. They will blame everyone except themselves. I know that there are cultures na talagang masyadong ganito. Naalala niyo yung testimony ni Rabbi Zacharias, kanilang silang magkakapatid, they are not allowed to be number two in school. Pag nag-number two sila, they'll be in trouble with their parents. You need to be number one. And that led to his suicide. And look at what happened to him. Great accomplishment. But behind that great accomplishment is a rebellion of the heart against God. And he died a rebel against God. So yun ang titignan natin. Let us teach our children to be diligent in their life, not for what they can get, but because that is what God wants them to do. Proverbs 14:23. In all toil, there is profit, but mere talk tends only to poverty. In all toil, there is profit, but mere talk tends only to poverty. One of the things that make parents and even people around children is their ability to talk. Their ability to express themselves, to articulate what they have in their mind. Tuwan-tuwa tayo dun sa mga batang yan. And I cannot deny, when I talk to my grandchildren, yun ang bagay na talaga. It gives me much joy. Children that can tell story. They can talk about their plans. They can talk about what they think things are. And some of these may grow up good talkers. Always having knowledge and opinion on how to do things. May mga taong ganun, di ba? Pag you ask them a subject and they would readily tell you. They're always ready to give you an advice. But it's all talk. But their life is not really a life of diligence. It's okay. Let us teach our children how to talk, how to express themselves. But talking should not be made a substitute for working. Children must be taught responsibilities. Yung good talker, sila yung mga magaling mga tuwiran kung ba't nila nagawa yung mga bagay na pinagagawa sa kanila. Sila yung magaling gumawa ng excuse if they were unable to fulfill their task because they can talk. And most often, the adult are just entertained when children can really reason out. I have a child, please don't guess, who has the ability to draw reason from the air that would really make you laugh. He can draw reasons from the air why he cannot do something, why he cannot go to that place, why he doesn't want to do something. And you'll be amazed how good a talker. And sometimes, natutuwa tayo sa ganun. But we must teach our children less talk and more responsibility. We are not to accept. May nakikita pa nga ako sa Facebook na pinupost nila, tuwantuwa yung mga magulang dahil yung children at their very small age become rationalizer, rationalizing everything. We are not to let our children make talking a substitute for doing things diligently. Proverbs 15, verse 19. The way of a sluggard is like a hedge of thorns, but the path of the upright is a level highway. Now try to imagine yung picture na pinakita sa atin. What does a hedge do to you? When you are walking, when you are doing something, everything is may mga hedge. Anong binibigay sa atin ito? Difficulties. That's one of my weakness that I'm trying to straighten. But when I work, many times I spend so much time looking for that yung mga tools na ginamit. I just put it here. Tapos hahanapin ko, makikita ko sa bathroom, dinala ko pala ron. And also, before, wala akong system, saka tambak lang lahat, materials and everything around my workplace. And I spent so much time just doing this thing. Kaya nga may mga plan uli akong project ngayon. What I plan to do first, which I already started, is again to arrange my tools and fix all my materials because they would be hedged along the way. But here, Solomon is not only talking about a hedge, but a hedge of thorns. Hedge of thorns. Makakasugat. It can break your skin. It can damage you. That is the way of a sluggard. Yung laziness will come back to you. Tell your children, your laziness will come back to you. It would hinder you from performing. It would hinder you when you seek comfort and happiness. It would hinder you. I saw a young woman when I visited somebody. Yung tinatamad mag-fix ng kulambo, malamok sa kanilang lugar, sa tabi sila kasi ng Laguna Dibay. Ang ginawa niya, instead of fixing, hanging the mosquito net, she just covered her entire self with the mosquito net. And you can see the outline of the mosquito doon sa kanyang mukha, sa katawan, sa paa. And she woke up with all this red portion of skin because of mosquitoes. It's because of the laziness. Because of laziness. Feeling to keep, halimbawa, yung mga pagkain, umukas na yan, kinabukasan ng panis. Wala nangyari. Damit na hindi nalaban, nabulok, nasira, kinain ng daga. All this, we must teach our children that the way of a sluggard is damaging. It's uncomfortable just because you are able to free yourself from some responsibility, it would damage you in the long run. Some of this may grow up, sometimes, this is just too literal. Sa kanila, literal ito pinapakitang ito ni Solomon. It was literal for them that a son who is a sluggard would soon, pati yung dadaanan niya, would soon, yung path that he would regularly use would be full of hedges that would make for him difficult to even just walk away from the house. But to us, we can also see reality when things are not kept properly, when the house is so messy. Nawawala yung ating freedom to move. Nawawala yung ating freedom to do things. But what is most significant in this is the contrast. The sluggard is contrasted with what? Look at the passage. Proverbs 15:19. The way of a sluggard is like a hedge of thorns. But the path of the what? The upright. You would imagine that what would be said is that the way of the sluggard is a hedge of thorns, but the way of the diligent. But no, it's not diligent. The way of the upright, meaning being a sluggard, is the opposite of being upright. It's unrighteousness to be sluggard, to be lazy, to be inorderly. Is a sign, is an expression of unrighteousness. Again, Proverbs 16, verse 26. Proverbs 16, verse 26. A worker's appetite works for him. His mouth urges him on. Now look at the picture. Here is a man who is working with great motivation because he wanted to satisfy his appetite. He wanted to eat. So he works to eat. So anong sinasabi natin dito? Solomon is telling his son, it's perfectly right and legitimate to labor under the motivation of hunger or want. If you want something, if you want to achieve something, if you want to eat, if you want comfort, if you want this thing, it's legitimate for you to be motivated by what you want and work. Oh, I thought everything must be done for the glory of God. Yes. And to glorify God is to imitate God. And God is a working God. God performs things. And therefore, hindi naman ito pinababayaan that you would set aside God. When you want something and then you realize, I want this and God wants me to work to do this, then I'll do it. So it's perfectly right and legitimate to labor under the motivation of hunger or what? You want good food, labor for it. You want a more comfortable house, you work harder without neglecting other responsibilities, especially responsibility to the soul. It's just right. It's perfectly all right to use God's means in achieving or acquiring things while being motivated by what you want. It's not only that it is all right, the Bible even denounced those who want something but refuse to work. Remember the directive of Paul to the Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians 3:10? For even when we were with you, we would give you this command. If anyone is not willing to work, let him not eat. If he is not willing to work, let him not eat. In other words, Solomon was telling his children, teaching his children, that they must be motivated by what they want and then obey the Lord and follow what the Lord is wanting them to do. That is teaching his children that good things are only for the diligent. Eat well, but thought to be part. Gustong kumain itong pinupunta rito ni Apostle Paul. Ito yung mga who heard that Jesus Christ is about to come. So they spend their time in mountains and as if praying and waiting, looking at the sky, waiting for the Lord. And then they will get hungry. Bababa, pupunta sa bahay ng kapatid. Makikikain. Children must be taught, according to Solomon, that good things are only for the diligent. You want to eat well? Then you must learn at least to be part of the preparation. Gusto nyo makakain tayo sa oras? You help cook, set the table, ready everything, then we will be able to eat on time. You want to eat good food? You help in the preparation. You know, dapat matutunan ng mga bata. If they want good life, they need to work for it. One area that this is violated is in the area of recreation. I have mentioned especially boys are just allowed almost the entire day doing recreation while the girls are washing dishes and washing clothes. They are allowed to just do whatever they want. To do some recreation. And when it's time to eat, they will be called to eat. Recreation is well deserved by the diligent in the responsibility that they might be. You in diligence a responsibility that they might be recreated. That's the purpose of recreation. Recreation is to recreate when we have been so diligent in our responsibility in what we are tasked to do. We are so diligent, you need to rest. You need to recreate. You need to refresh your mind. You need to have joy because you have been working hard. Yun ang kailangan. Recreation is well deserved in those areas. There used to be a time that recreation is allowed on children only after responsibility. Everything nung araw during primitive time, the children are part of the upkeep of the house, the farm, everything is done. And when afternoon comes, children, let's do some recreation. We have accomplished so much, let's do some recreation. Those were the days. The children are allowed after a day of responsibility. We, during our time, we can only play when the sun is getting down. Doon kami nagpapatintero, tumpapreso, but the whole day we were working. We were helping our parents. And kaya kung di ako believe dun sa masyadong against child labor. If you will know my life, you would say that I was abused as a child, but I don't see it as an abuse. I learned to work for things that I want. We can only have play and recreation in the afternoon. Tapos na lahat. Nabalatan ko na yung kinasabi ko. Hindi ko makalimutan talaga na yung pagtatalupin ako ng nanay ko ng isang sako. Alam niyo yung kajos? Yung dried pods with black beans inside. Bibili yung nanay ko nun, lalagay doon sa malapat. O, balatan nito. Magsisimula kami magkakapatid, tapos mawala ako na lang mag-isa. Pagtapos ko ng balatan, kala ko tapos na. Tingnan mo nanay ko, bubuhos na naman yung isang pangsako. But at night, we look forward to the night when we can really play. Eh, konti lang ang bata rin, kami lang magkakapatid. We really play. May ginawa kong bahay-bahayan, doon kami, nagsasayang kami, we play. Tumira pa kami sa tita ko na talagang bawal ang recreation, hanggang hindi tapos lahat. Kailangan walang empty vessel, lahat must be filled with water. Ako yung hakot ng tubig. Ang problema, habang naghahakot ka, naglalabas siya, hindi matapos-tapos. We really worked hard. Those were the days na ganun ang mga bata. Today, children live the day as if the entire day is for them to play and to interact with their friends. Yung mga magulang, what do they do? What they do is that bibigay lang yung mga laruan doon sa kanilang mga anak. Do your thing. And look what kind of young people, that kind of training produce a generation of sluggard, a generation without control for recreation. How much time is spent on video games and doing nothing? Look at this generation, 20 to 30 years old. Mukha ng mga tatay ang tiyan. And you know, if you have fat bellies, you know the reason. You are taking in food more than you can burn. In other words, the muscles are not working. The only muscle that is working is the muscle of the stomach. So you're getting in food that you cannot burn. And what do you do with that food? You store it in your belly. These are the kinds of teenagers that is being produced today. Several reasons can be given by someone who does not, na hindi nakatapos ng kanyang trabaho o yung hindi magawa nito, but isa lang ang explanation ng scripture. They're sluggard. They're sluggard. We must teach our children work and the true meaning of recreation. It's to recreate. After a diligent work, they must recreate. They must be, I'm not saying that this recreation is evil, that video games are totally evil, but they must fall under the category of recreation. Life is not play. Life is not recreation. Lalo na, alam mo, kung tuturo mo, lalo na yung mga lalaki. Mga lalaki kasi is prone to doing nothing. You know that? We're psychologically prone to do nothing. Tingnan mo yung ano. Look at yung mga fathers. Yung complain nila sa mga fathers, di ba? Uupo sa television. Hawak yung lipat ng lipat. Wala namang pinapanood. Maghapon yun. Walang pinapanood yun. Doing nothing. Isabi ng isang speaker, yung fishing. Sino mahilig sa line fishing? Mga lalaki lang. Have you seen someone doing line fishing? Ako po yung maghapon. Naghihintay na may kumagat. Pag may... Wala pa. Puno na naman. Samtala yung mga babae, hindi nila alam kung paano may tita ako na lagi may hawak basahan yun. Kahit naglalakad lang. Punas ng punas. But the boys, the boys suppose that the entire life is playing. And we just tolerate as parents. Teach them the real meaning of recreation. I mentioned pot belly. I'm not yet in the meron tayong section doon para sa self-control. We'll deal with that. Proverbs 18:9. Whoever slack in his work is a brother to him who destroys. Now again, this is taken from an agricultural context or atmosphere. An enemy of our enemy can destroy what we have planted. It can burn, it can send wild animals that can destroy what we have worked for, we have planted. An enemy can destroy your plants that will limit your harvest. But so that someone who works but with a slack hand, a slack hand during harvest, just imagine, yung slack hand, yung during harvest, yung hindi inaayos yung pagkakabuhat sa mga doon sa kanyang mga harvest, nahuhulog lahat yung mga yon, napapabayaan, sumasapot, tinatamad na siyang pulutin. So ang sinasabi rito is, yung mga tao hindi diligent in doing, in performing, having a slack hand, they are just in the league of those who destroy. Ecclesiastes 9:10 says, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with your might. You can discern in your children those who would simply give a token performance para makita lang na ginawa niya. Maghuhugas ng plato pero hindi maayos, hindi lilinisin yung lababo. Magliligpit ng kanyang kama dahil sinabihan mo pero hindi magandang pagkakatiklop. Hindi magaganda yung pagkakaayos. Alam niyo, yung tatay ko noon, kulang na lang paggamitin ako ng metro sa kaskwala, pagtiklop ng kulambo at na kailangan yung kumot nakapantay doon sa unan at yung kulambo hindi basta-basta. Pag ako nagkabit ng kulambo, kailangan pantay yun, ha? Naka-level yun. Kulang na lang gumamit yung hose na level talaga lahat dapat yun. And you would discern from your children, just watching them, you would know that there are those who will just give a token performance. They have slack hand. They are just like those who destroy. Proverbs 19:15. Slothful cast into a deep sleep, and an idle person will suffer hunger. We have discussed this in earlier passages, that slothfulness, kakambal yan ng gustong patulog. Slothfulness and love of sleep, magkasama yan. At yung slothful, yung tamad, yung mahilig matulog, siya rin yung laging idle. Yung idle. Hindi ko alam kung hanggang ngayon. Nung araw, bawal kami gumanyan. Hindi, ganun pa ba yung mga parents ngayon? Nung araw, hindi kami pwedeng gumanyan. Tamad yan. Pagagalitan po ng tatay ko noon. Hindi pwedeng naka... ayaw sa pagkain. Pag gumanyan ka, ako magagalit sa'yo. Kasi... that's a picture of idleness. That's a picture of slothfulness, sabi ng tatay ko. Hindi ko lang kung ba't ako lang tinitrain na ganyan eh. Kailangan bago sumikat ng araw, gising na ako. Siguro, ako yung pinakamatandang lalaki, kaya ako yung tinitrain ng tatay ko doon sa mga bagay na ganon. Proverbs 19:24. Proverbs 19:24. The sluggard buries his hand in the dish and will not even bring it back to his mouth. So there is humor still in the teaching of Solomon. Imagine the picture. Nagsangag yung tao, nilagay sa bowl, isinerve sa harapan niya, nagpray siya, nagpasalamat, nilagay yung kamay niya rin sa tapos natulog na. Will not even lift up the hand at ilalagay doon sa kanyang mouth. A sluggard buries his hand in the dish and will not even bring it back to his mouth. Sluggard knows what he wants. He will work for it, but he would quit even before having yung fruit of his labor. Now, several reasons can be given by someone who does not finish the job. Quitter ang mga ano eh, ang mga sluggard quitter. And we can think of many reasons. Lost appetite, siguro sabi natin, kaya hindi kinain, nawala ng gana. Or sometimes we encounter difficulties. But the Bible has only one reason why a person will not finish what he started. Being sluggard. It's the only reason. given by the Word of God. Proverbs 20 verse 4, the sluggard does not plow in the autumn, he will seek a harvest and have nothing. So nakita niyo yung dullness ng mind. He will not do his task on the time that he must do it. But he would still seek fruit. He would still want something during the time when he is only supposed to be harvesting what he has planted. Verse 13 of Proverbs 20, again, that's connection of sleep and poverty. Love not sleep, lest you come to poverty. Open your eyes and you will have plenty of bread. That is, be diligent in your work. Another characteristic of the sluggard, Proverbs 22:13. A sluggard is a rationalizer. The sluggard says, there is a lion outside. I should be killed in the streets. Parang sinabi ng tatay, bring the garbage out. No, I cannot. There's a lion outside. O sige, hindi outside. Wala na, tinignan mo outside. Wala. Verse 13 of chapter 26. There is a lion in the road. Wala dyan sa labas natin, pero nandun na, may lion. Hindi ako pwede. A rationalizer. And children are just championing, drawing reason from the air to tell us that he cannot do his task. Yun yung mga tamad na kinakausap dito ni Solomon. We must not allow our children. Ito yung tinuturo ni Solomon, to be sluggard. Pag-aralan niyo yung activities ng ating mga anak. Yung mga anak natin, basta kakain na lang. O inaasok na lang nila na pagbukas ko ng cabinet, nandun na yung damit ko, malinis na. We should teach them to be diligent. I-ready yung kanilang mga damit, itignan, kung hindi, kung nalaban na o hindi. That should be their training. Kahapon nag-ano na naman yung nagbibiroan na naman yung mga anak ko kasi nung maliliit sila, kahit saan sila tumingin, may schedule. Yung schedule nilang maghapong gawain nila from the time they wake up at the time na lights off, it's scattered everywhere they turn. Sabi, ano yung word na ginamit ni Happy sa akin kahapon? May ginamit siyang word na and a trauma, that's how we were traumatized. Everywhere they go, and we only play, they can only play in the afternoon. We must teach our children. We will not always be with them. One day they will be on their own. And I can also say, there is no guarantee that they'll be able to imbibe everything that you would teach them about diligence. But the good thing is you can look up the face of God and say, Lord, as far as I know and as far as the ability that you have given me is concerned, I have done what I must do. And then you will have a good conscience in praying for them kung merong pagkukulang at pagkakamali. So with that, let us not raise up sluggard. Let us raise up diligent children who knows the blessing of diligence and the curse of being a sluggard. Let's all pray. O aming Panginoon, muli kaming nagpapakumbaba sa iyo. Nakita muli namin, Panginoon, in what area we either us failing as parents o yung nakuha namin sa aming mga magulang. But now that we know, we have no more excuse. And so, Lord, we do pray that you would so bless everything that we have discussed. You bless this, Lord, in our hearts and in our mind. Thank you, Father. May you prepare us now, Lord, para sa aming pong pagsamba mamaya. In Christ's name. Amen.